so much depend upon a red wheelbarrow glazed with rainwater beside the white chicken? Those are the words to a poem by William Carlos Williams many, many years ago. And words, those are words. So much depends upon a red wheelbarrow glazed in rainwater beside the white chickens. Words are all we have to communicate verbally with. It's my intention we open our hearts for what words cannot say. There are no words for the near-death experience. There are no words for love. We call it love. But what I'm touching upon is what is behind love. What is behind the word. The images that conjure up in your mind here in the beautiful town of Austin, Texas, about red wheelbarrows being glazed with rainwater by white chickens. It's not the words, it's what you feel about the words. It's what your mind's eye sees and recognizes. What I say. Wisdom. What is wisdom? Now, I grew up on a little farm, and my father used to tell me, wisdom is knowledge applied. It does you no good to know something unless you do something about it. It's knowledge applied. Lock the gate. There's an Arabic saying, trust in God, but tie up the camel. Wisdom is knowledge applied. Death. Perhaps death is what gives life meaning. We have so much conversation around death. What happens afterwards? What do I have to look forward to? What's next? And I love the stories. I embrace the stories. What did it look like? What did it smell like? What did it taste like? Over there. What about here, now? Perhaps death is what gives life meaning. Perhaps death, that end, is what gives us relevance now. I was recently watching some March Madness. And I enjoy that in this realm. That's exciting. You know what gives the game meaning? That it's going to end. You know, there's so many periods, and there's so many minutes in a period, and there's so many seconds in that minute. And such is life. Death gives life meaning. It gives it relevance. It's what makes it exciting. We look at death as this bad thing, this end point. Death is a birth. Death is a new beginning. Death is simply a passing. And perhaps a remembering. There's an indigenous tribe, and when a young woman becomes pregnant, when she first knows that there's life within her, it is the tradition that she begins to write a song. She writes a unique song that is for the child that is coming. She writes the song, she learns the song, she sings the song, and I'm sure she probably rubs and pats her tummy as she sings the song, when she knows the song. She then teaches it to the father of the child. She teaches the father the song of this life that is in her. And the father learns the song. When the mother and the father know the song, they teach the family the song. Of this child, the unique song for that one that's coming. And when the family knows the song, they teach the community, the tribe, they teach them the song for this beautiful soul that's on its way When the child is born, the entire community sings the song to welcome the child into the world. When the child has a birthday, the family or the community, whoever's gathered, sings their song. Maybe most critical, when that child becomes bigger or older, and when they do something that doesn't work in the society, when they do something that's out of the norm or that causes pain or that does something to hurt someone in the tribe, rather than beating or shaming or locking up, they bring that person to the center. And the tribe sings their song. That they might remember who they are. So much of my near-death experience was remembering. It felt as if I was learning nothing but remembering. Now, my near-death experience was the result of an automobile accident. I was with my entire family. It was me, my wife, and my two young sons in the back seat. One of the most relevant things, perhaps, about the accident was the moments before it. You know, I talked about the game. But the game of life has hours and minutes, and within those minutes are seconds, and within those seconds, I believe there are moments. And those moments are beautifully aligned up where life is simply a chain of moments, moment to moment to moment. And within those moments are an absolute eternity. Have you ever had a time when just time didn't exist? It literally stood still. A moment where there was no time. As I had put the family in the car and everybody was buckled in. I was buckled in. My wife was buckled in. And we had said goodbye to her family. We were ready to make our way. In a moment, my wife, her name is Tamara, she reached over and said, "Jeff, hang on a moment. I want to go say goodbye to Mom and Dad one more time." Now, in that moment, as a man and in this realm, I thought, oh my gosh, women. You know, really? We've hugged. We've got to go. But I pulled the car in park, and I watched as she got out of the car. And she went to her mother, and she kissed her. And she hugged her. And she went to her father, and she kissed him, and she hugged him. And I noticed it. In that moment, when time stood still and I watched her not only hug but kiss her parents and then come joyfully running back to the car, I jumped in and buckled in, she was ready to go. Now, notice what you notice in those sacred moments. And I'll promise you, every moment is sacred. And of course, I put the car in drive and I hit the interstate and I gassed it up to 75 miles an hour and set the cruise control to make time. Racing against that crazy clock. The moments, the seconds, the minutes, the hours. Then I had my moment as I'm driving up the interstate thinking about all the things I had to do at work. I glanced in the rearview mirror to check traffic and noticed my youngest son, just a toddler, 14 months old, but I noticed that he was sound asleep in his car seat. And time stood still. I noticed how his hands lay on the car seat. I noticed that, gosh, I probably have to trim his fingernails. I noticed how long his eyelashes were. And I thought, what had kept him? We've been told we would never have more children after Spencer came. And he was a miracle. I then just glanced at Spencer, my oldest son, 7 years old, sitting behind me, playing with action figures. And I noticed the noises he was making. You know, the grandest noises of a white city battle of the galaxy is joyous, beautiful, little boy. And then I noticed my wife, who had also fallen sound asleep. And she was holding my hand. And I noticed how she held my hand. She only held on to 3 fingers. I don't know why she had small hands, but I noticed that after 10 years of marriage and 2 sons, and both of us actively engaged in our careers, she was a teacher, I noticed she was still holding my hand. The same way she had on our first date, when I was a starving college student and had a couple bucks in my pocket to take her to a dollar. But I noticed it in those moments. Of course, my attention was back on the road and away we went. It was about an hour after that that I had my negative experience as, in a moment, I dozed off at the wheel, just for a second. But as I did so, we swerved to the right, I overcorrected to the left, and the car began to roll. Not off the road, but down the road at 75 miles an hour. It was a horrific automobile accident. Now, I blacked out for most of that, and yet when the car came to a halt, I was completely conscious. And the first thing I heard was Spencer. What was the joyful noises of play were suddenly the horrific cries of my 7-year-old son. Hysterical crying. And I knew as a father, I have got to get to him. I've got to get to my boy. That's when I realized that I could not move. I was pinned and I couldn't tell if it was to the floorboard or the seat. I was struggling to see, I was struggling to breathe. I had no idea of the injuries at that time. I just wanted to get to my son. What had actually happened is that both of my legs had been crushed. The left leg was amputated above the knee. My back had been damaged. However, the spinal column was not injured. My right arm had almost been torn off. And the seatbelt had cut through me and ruptured all my intestines. I had no idea. All I knew was my child was crying. I had to get to him. And that's when the brutal reality hit that no one else was crying. It was then that I knew that Griffin, my little toddler boy, and Tamara were gone. Now, I don't talk about this very much. But in this setting and the inspiration of the day and what's gone on, I want to touch on a couple of things. And please, this is not to be morbid. Griffin was thrown from the car. And I was aware of that. What took Tamara so quickly was head trauma. And I was aware of that. And in that absolute hell of a hysterical 7-year-old, of knowing that Griffin had been thrown from the car, and I knew that that was fatal. I felt it. And knowing that Tamara was gone, it was in that absolute horrific moment, the darkest moment of my life, that light came. Light came. I was surrounded by light. It was a light so tangible, it was comforting. That's why I share that, not to be graphic, but in that worst chaos, this light came and began to comfort me and began to raise me above the drama and trauma of what had happened. Now, I was wondering what was going on. I could suddenly breathe, I could see, I could feel no pain. I was what's happening? What's happening? And as I became aware that I was in this beautiful, tangible light that seemed to be comforting me, suddenly Tanner, my wife, who I knew was deceased at the scene, was right there with me. And the only reason I shared what I did is because as I looked at her, she was okay too. She was beautiful, gorgeous. There was no trauma. There she was, and she was okay. I was so joyful. Oh, in fact, my thought was, are we okay? What's happening? And although she was okay, she began to become emphatic. You've got to go back. You've got to go back. You can't be here. You've got to go back. Now, I've heard several touch on free will and choice. For me, there's only one cosmic rule. It's free will and choice. You get to choose. And here I was looking at the woman I loved more than life. And yet I knew I had a little boy crying in the backseat of that car. And I got to choose. Now, coming back into this realm was interesting because I have no concept of time in that bubble of light. I have no idea how long it took. I later learned that people came to the scene of the accident. One happened to be a doctor. They could do emergency procedures on me and take care of things. They rushed both Spencer and I to a little local hospital. They knew they could do nothing for me. They called Life Flight. They Life Flighted me into a level one trauma center. Spencer, my 7-year-old, was not badly injured. He was banged up a little bit. He cracked a bone in his wrist and his wrists were bruised, but he basically walked away from the accident. However, emotionally, he thought his whole family was gone. They life-flighted me to a hospital. I had no idea. All I knew is I had crashed the car. I had said the most profound goodbye I'll ever say. And when I made that choice to come back, I found myself wandering around the hospital. When I say wandering, floating, moving, endlessly, freely around, but I was encountering everyone in the hospital. I was experiencing them, the patients, the doctors, the nurses, the families of the patients. And everyone I saw, I knew them absolutely perfectly. I knew their love, their hate, their trauma, their decisions, their motivations, their anxieties, their joys. I knew them as if they were me. I had this absolute, unbelievable, undeniable connection. They were me. Now, I come from a Christian background. And a biblical verse popped into my head as I was encountering these amazing, beautiful souls. And I can promise you, it did not matter whether they were a heroin addict, or whether they had been in a traumatic accident of some kind, or whether they were a saintly grandmother there for a grandchild. They were all absolutely perfect. Judgment went out the window. I was seeing these souls as divine, glorious beings, regardless of what their life looked like, or the choices they had made, and that was new for me. I had become kind of judgmental in my background of being right and wanting to be right, wanting to prove that I was right, and suddenly that went away. The biblical verse says that as much as you have done to the least of these, you've done it to me. And I knew those verses. When did we do that? Well, when I was hungry, when I was in prison. And suddenly it had a whole new meaning. I used to believe, well, that's a nice verse about being nice. I was experiencing the oneness. I realized the master teacher that said that knew that he was them and held himself no better than the beggar in the street that was naked or the man in prison who had committed a crime. We are all one. We are all together. I was experiencing that oneness until I finally came up to a body that I didn't feel anything from, a man laying on the gurney that I didn't feel this compassion, this love, this connection, and I stepped forward simply to look and realized, oh my gosh, that's me. But it wasn't me. I was here having this divine, incredible, profound experience, and yet there was my body.
But there was reverence for that body. Wow. And it was a mess. I used to be a Division I athlete once upon a time. I was actually fast, believe it or not. But I looked at that broken body and I thought, wow. And I also had insights. I realized that my body truly is a temple. What a gift. And here it was so broken. But I knew I was to get back in. And again, it's choice. I enjoyed Dr. Neal's speech last night about laying back down in the body. As I looked at my body, it's like, how do I get back in? And I immediately knew. Intention. How did you get back in the hospital? I made a choice. We have no idea how powerful our intentions are. I'm going back in, and as quick as I made the conscious thought, boom, I was back in the body, but back to the trauma, back to the pain. And the biggest one for me was the guilt. Gosh, I was driving the car. What happened? Can't I take that back? Can't I do something different? Where's my 7-year-old? Where are the other two? I was ventilated. They put a big, ventilator, so I couldn't speak. My legs were obviously immobile. My right arm was immobile. They tied down my left arm because I kept grabbing at all the medical equipment. And I learned the holy meaning of be still. Be still. I had no choice. I mean, had I been, I'd have gone up and ran. I'd have punched something. I'd have done something. But literally there, in my body, in my temple, entertaining the thoughts of in my head. Life does this. You ever made that journey from your head to your heart, from your head to your heart? Boy, did I have to ever get in my heart. I learned a lot in those months. I was in the hospital for 5 months. I had 18 surgeries in total, patching me back together. I was halfway in this realm and halfway in that realm for literally weeks upon weeks. I was in ICU for almost 2.5 to 3 months. I kept going back. I would throw pulmonary aneurysms, the blood clots that lodge in your lungs. I had horrible infections from all that had taken place. I learned about caring. They had to leave the stomach wounds open, and they would pack them every day with gauze and then have to strip them out. Apparently that assists in the healing. And at one point, my brother was there, and the nurse got so sick she vomited. She couldn't, it just was too much. And my brother stepped in, he said, I'll do it. He was a trainee, he knew what to do. And of course, I'm wincing at the pain and what's going on, and he's talking to me as a man talks, and I won't use that language up here. But lay down, stay still, you big sissy, knock it off. And I'm sitting there thinking, what, you're really so mean to me? Till I looked up, and as he's telling me, knock it off, man up, I see tears rolling down his cheeks. As he's packing the wounds of his little brother, I learned what a real man is. To be a gentle man is divine. Months went on, I did begin to heal. I got better. I went from ICU to surgical recovery and finally in the rehabilitation wing. Now, I think it's relevant to say my near-death experiences were most profound, and I had many brushes with the other side. I had a conversation with my deceased wife in the hospital about where she wanted to be buried and how. She wanted Griffin in her arms. She let me know what song she wanted sung at the services, a little Celtic song. About having a dove in your heart that only sings to you.
It's been 20 years, folks. It still is fresh. The most profound near death experiences were at the scene of the accident before I had any narcotics. I mean, I was on a lot of morphine in the hospital, and everyone would say, well, you know. But at the scene of the accident, I had no narcotics, and at the end of my hospital stay was the most profound experience of all. And I was out of surgical recovery. I was in the rehabilitation wing. They just finished some surgery. I was on Tylenol. I was taking some Tylenol for pain. That's the only drug that was in my body. And I went to sleep one night. This time my other brother was there. My brothers practically lost their jobs to be by my side. And he was teasing me because I'd laid on my back so long, the back of my head was rubbed bald. And he's like, he was starting to actually go bald. He's like, whoa, this is awesome. You know, you're going bald too. And I rolled on my side. He had stabilized my abdominal injuries to the point I could lay on my side. And I remember thinking, it's still so good to lay on my side. That's how I normally sleep. I've been on my back for months. And I fell into a deep sleep, a beautiful sleep. And I even was conscious thinking, wow, this is such a beautiful sleep. I haven't slept like this for, wow. And then I felt that light. Suddenly that light came again, that tangible light. Now, I didn't experience a tunnel. My near-death experience may not even be typical. It was that light. It was as smooth and easy as from stepping from one room to the next, like going through the threshold of a door. That lift came, I thought, wow, I know this. I know this. Except this time, the light went away. And I was there alone. But I was in the most beautiful place. And you've heard this already. People talk about heaven, the spirit world, the other side, the other realms. I was home. I was absolutely home. I mean, so welcome. So home. Again, words. What are words? I was at the place or the thing that is behind the word home. And I began to run. It was a physical experience. I began to run. I could feel the sensation of the ground under my feet. I could feel all the energy charging through my calves and thighs. It was so much more physical. Again, I don't know the word. I was feeling in such a way, joyfully running and thinking, I'm home. I'm home. Now, I suppose, as was mentioned this morning, in the body, out of the body, well, I suppose I was out of the body because my body was in a hospital bed, but boy, did it ever feel well. I could feel everything. And it was at that moment that I realized I'm not here to stay. I just knew. And there was a corridor. And it's interesting. I only noticed about the corridor that it was beautifully designed. I noticed there was no window panes in it, although there were spaces for windows. For whatever that's worth, and it really doesn't matter, but I began to make my way down the corridor until I could see the end, and at the end was a crib. And so I raced to the crib. And when I peeked in, there I saw Griffin, my little toddler, as beautiful and as perfect as he was when I glanced in the rearview mirror and he was sleeping in that car seat. Now, you can only imagine the joy of me seeing him whole and perfect and healthy, knowing what had happened and what I was aware of at the scene. And I picked him up in my arms and I grasped him and held him, and that was tangible. I could feel his little body against mine. Now, I don't pretend to think that my son was a little toddler in heaven. I don't know. I've experienced him since then as a grown 29-year-old young man. He wasn't quite that old, but in my dream, I didn't appear that old. But the universe is so kind. God is so good. Somewhere in this cosmic realm of chaos, somebody knew I needed to hold my little boy. And I did. And I smelled his hair. And I can feel his breath on my neck. And I